You're now listening to TSC Rapid Fire on the PRO Media Network.
What's going on, sports world? It's Big Q from the Sports Coma chiming on with you with this current episode of TSC Rapid Fire, the Sports Coma full podcast show coming soon. Working on a schedule, fam, you know, so that, you know, we'll be able to get this content. Right now, it's a lot of busy stuff going on, a lot of sport-related stuff going on, delivering it to you. But coming up soon, we'll release a schedule for the PRO Media Network and give you a schedule format when things will come out. So we're working on that. That hopefully will be done in the next several days. So, but getting right into today's episode of TSC Rapid Fire, we're going to be talking to you about the Saints' unofficial depth chart. And of course, they released this a few days ago. Needed a little time to go over it. What I see from the Saints doing with this unofficial depth chart is they're lining up for Thursday's matchup against Jacksonville. It's going to be interesting because looking at the depth chart, I'm going to start on the offensive side of it because the offense make everything go, right? You know, I've looked at it, and of course, you can see it on your screen right now. Saints have, it's no surprises with Michael Thomas that we knew Mike Thomas was going to be there. I know Ted Ginn Jr., a lot of people think people are going to just unseat Ted Ginn Jr. like that. He was terrific last year. He's a natural fit in Sean Payton's offense. So it's not going to be that easy to unfit Ted Ginn Jr. He's still, by all accounts, the fastest, one of the fastest of top two or three fastest players on the team now. He was Deion Sanders and Jerry Rice fast when he came out of college. He, of course, he's a lot older and he probably, he lost a step, but he's still faster than most guys. You know, Ted Ginn's a freak. But I'm not surprised. I knew Mike Thomas and Ted Ginn, the most reliable wide receivers they have, they're going to be there. You look at the other skill position. They got, of course, Mark Ingram and Alvin Kamara starting. That's no surprise. There was Zach Lyon. He's the only fullback on the team, so he got it made. Of course, Drew Brees is the mainstay. And Benjamin Watson dealing with his consistency. You know, he wasn't the best of blockers, but Ben has gotten better, man. More reliable. And having Ben back, I think he'll have one of those tremendous seasons. I don't know if he's going to catch as many balls as he did when he was here the last time. You know, I don't know. But, you know, mostly our tight ends having a good season, catching 50 plus balls, between 50 to 60 balls. And if you get past 65 catches, then you really doing something special. But usually if you having a solid new season and you catching 80% or 90% of whatever Drew's throwing to you, you should be able to, because he uses his tight ends. You should have 60 to 70 catches at the end of the year. But, you know, we'll have to see on that. But Ben Watson's a good pick. Looking at the offensive line, Armstead, Andrus, Unger, Warford, Ramchick, no surprise there. Absolutely no surprise there. Let's look at the second stringers, though, how they have them listed. Cameron Meredith is there. Of course, Tre'Quan Smith is on the other side behind Ted Ginn's position. Is Tre'Quan Smith behind Michael Thomas? Is Cameron Meredith there behind him? And, of course, they have Brandon Tate, who just came in. They have him behind Cameron Meredith. That's eye-opening. Brandon Tate might be shining in camp for them to put this. Now, they say it's an unofficial depth chart, but obviously still interesting nonetheless. Now, they got Josh Huff underneath Tre'Quan Smith there as well. So, you know, that's interesting. Then they go to the third stringers, Tommy Lee Lewis and Kirkwood. So, they got Tommy Lee Lewis back there with Keith Kirkwood and the rest of the wide receivers, guys like Austin Carr and Michael Floyd, which, remember, Michael Floyd and Brandon Tate came in at the same time. So, we were looking at Michael Floyd, like, hey, man, Michael Floyd, he's a guy that was one of the high picks. You know, he was supposed to be the heir apparent to Larry Fitzgerald until he had all that foolishness off field. And then his career got thrown for a loop. And when he came in, Brandon Tate was basically an afterthought. Not anymore. Brandon Tate, of course, had an unofficial depth chart. He's sitting ahead of him in the second string. You look at the offensive lineman backups. Bushrod, we knew Bushrod was going to be there. Fullington didn't make the cut, although we knew if he didn't make the cut, one of these third stringer guys might move up. Of course, you know, you got Josh Laribius there who's not been playing well. Don Barclay, a guy who they picked up from Green Bay. He played with Detroit, who hasn't looked well as either. Nate Wozniak, who used to be a massive tight end for the University of Minnesota. They converted him to a tackle position. He's been okay. Will Clapp is another guy they've been giving a lot of reps with the second team, first team, to see what he can do. He's been looking better, but Andrew Tiller's another guy nobody talks about. He's a guy that is doing well, and he should climb up in this depth chart. And, of course, Rick Leonard. I haven't heard a damn thing about Rick Leonard. Crickets sounding behind me because of Rick Leonard. Not hearing a damn thing from Rick Leonard so far in camp. That'll probably, of course, change as we move forward. And of course, you look at the tight end position, Josh Shields behind Benjamin Watson. Then they got Garrett Griffin there. Then who's still injured, and Deion Yelda. Yelda hasn't separated himself. And then Dan Arnold is at the bottom of the tight end depth chart. I don't know. I think that's a little bit confusing, mislisted. Let's just put it like that. Dan Arnold, according to the stuff that we've been seeing from Dan Arnold and the footage that you've been seeing and eye test, he's been balling in Saints camp thus far. It's no way in the world that he's at the base of the tight end depth chart behind Deion Yelda, injured Michael Hulan, behind his depth chart, behind him on the depth chart. I just don't see that. I think Dan Arnold is probably somewhere in the top three of the tight end depth chart. And by the first couple of preseason games, we should see him a lot higher than that. Of course, Tom Savage and Taysom Hill and JT Barrett sits at the base, at the back of the QB depth chart. Tom Savage, at first I said Tom Savage was a, you know, I thought when he coming in, the Saints was like, well, we're going to just bring this guy in. Because I'm looking at the youth. I'm looking at an heir apparent to Drew Brees. And we look past Tom Savage, but he'll be the calming influence behind Drew Brees if something were to happen. So he's been looking good in camp. And for a smart quarterback veteran playing in a Sean Payton system, if you know what you're doing, you can really look good. Look what Luke McCown was able to do when he was here, when he filled in for Drew and Drew went out. If you're a smart QB, you can play in this system. And Tom Savage is doing that. He looks good, and Taysom Hill doesn't look so good. You know, and JT Barrett is, they have to really step their game up if they want to make the team. Going on the defensive side of the ball now, people. The defense, according to an official depth chart, has Alex Okafor sitting at the end position opposite of our favorite guy, Cam Jordan. Then if you look at the defensive tackle, Sheldon Rankins and Daniel Yamada is co-starters in that position. So according to what Sean Payton or whoever created this unofficial depth chart is telling us, is that those guys are 1A and 1B or perhaps 1A and 1AA. However you want to phrase it, but they're putting them on the same level. Now, this is quite the thing for David Onyemata, being that he was from Canada, played up in Canada, and this guy, Sheldon Rankins, who was one of the top tackles in the draft, this guy was a raw prospect, they call him. He's climbed to the level where Sheldon Rankins is. Oh, that cannot be overstated. Y'all have to think about that. That's a lot to say, that David Onyemata was able to get where Sheldon Rankins at, to the point where he's right there listed with him as a co-starter in unofficial depth chart. Now, of course, the nose tackle position is Tyler Davison, who's been strong there. But Jay Bromley, who I love, that's a football name for you. That's a football name, Jay Bromley. Jay Bromley is playing well. Now, this is a veteran guy that played with the Giants. He's a run stuffing guy. He can put a little pressure on you, too. And he's giving Tyler Davison some competition in camp, you know. And of course, this is Tyler Davison's last year, and he got to show up and show up. So this is a contract year for Tyler Davison. Behind those guys on the depth chart, we're going to run down the rest of them, though. Well, let's stop right there and analyze those defensive linemen. Then we'll go to the linebackers and cornerbacks. Behind him, first guy off the bench, defensive end Marcus Davenport, for Alex Okafor, or Cameron Jordan. Then that's Trey Hendrickson. In the second strings, the defensive tackles is Devereaux Lawrence. Now, that's interesting, because for the defensive tackle behind Sheldon Rankins and David Onyemata, usually one of those guys would be in that position where Devereaux Lawrence is. But it's interesting that the Saints brass see Devereaux Lawrence, who was on his team last year, got hurt, and the Saints shelved him. But they really like Devereaux, and he's head and shoulders, according to what we're saying, over Woody Hamilton, Taylor Stalwart, and Henry Mondu. Now, I've heard about Taylor Stalwart. He's one of my favorite undrafted prospects. Woody Hamilton's a long shot, but Henry Mondu, haven't heard a goddamn thing on Henry Mondu. It's been crickets on him, and also El Kadim Muhammad. If you go to, he's listed as a third stringer back there with Alex Jenkins, who's a guy you give him an opportunity to get on the field. Alex Jenkins is going to remain on that field. I'm telling y'all, keep an eye out for Alex Jenkins. But, you know, this is what we're looking at. Trey Hendrickson, and then, of course, Mitchell Lowen and George Johnson. You know, those guys sit there. Trey Hendrickson, this is a year you're going to see a lot from Trey Hendrickson. This guy is going to be a terrific, and his season last year was cut short due to injuries, but he's a player. And I just feel really good about the Saints having players like Trey Hendrickson, Marcus Davenport, coming off that bench. Mitchell Lowen was a guy that is one of my favorites. I think Mitchell Lowen can play a multitude of different positions and probably ultimately end up making his team. A lot of great competition on a defensive line this year. Let's go to the next level, the linebackers. Well, they got listed at the wheel or the weak side position, Demario Davis, which is interesting. Manti Te'o, which is interesting, sitting at the middle position. And then, of course, the Sam or the strong side, they got AJ Klein. Now, this is interesting altogether because, number one, Manti Te'o, really, who had that position? Looking at the Mike position, a lot of people thought it'd be Demario Davis. But we know Double D can play all three of those positions, and he ain't tripping. We know AJ Klein can play all three of those positions. He ain't tripping. But not to see Alex Anzalone, one of my favorites, sitting in that starting three is very interesting. I guess the Saints won't see what those guys work with. Manti Te'o, man, a lot of people underestimating Manti Te'o. Last year, he's first time he played a full season in a long time. Of course, it was in a reserve position. But this guy's terrific. He's awesome. And at the end of the day, Manti Te'o continues to step up and show out as the Saints have this guy. Manti Te'o is showing up and showing out. He's always been a cerebral player at the position, played in the middle linebacker position for years. But he had a terrific year with that Notre Dame team. Came out, had that ridiculous sex scandal crap with the, I don't even much want to talk about it. It was so ridiculous. Then at the end of the day, injury plagued 4 years in San Diego. He's finally found a home with New Orleans and looked like he is the Saints like what he's doing at the middle linebacker position. That's really interesting to me. Behind him, of course, Alex Anzalone. A lot of this will change when they go to nickel packages or the three safety look and all this kind of stuff. So, but it's good to see that those guys have players that can play multitude of different positions. And of course, Craig Robinson is showing up in camp as well. He's a guy that a lot of people continue to ride down on, including myself at times. But Craig is a fighter, and I think Craig is knows how to play those positions. He's a energetic personality, and he's a perfect Saint player. A real interesting thing in the linebacker corner, the second string you look at is Haloi Kakaha. This is interesting because the depth chart doesn't have Kakaha listed at defensive end. They're trying to play him and keep him on the team as a linebacker. Remember the last time that happened when the Saints tried to play him at linebacker? You know, when Rob Ryan was here, didn't end up too well. Now, I'm saying that's the same thing going to happen this year, but wow. You know, Kakaha is trying to make the team as a linebacker. That doesn't bowl low for Haloi Kakaha. I remember I put him as one of my bubble guys on this year. Remember that from previous shows, guys. I know most of you family members that listen to the show, and I mean family members, I mean part of the PRO Media Network family. I heard the previous podcast. No, that I had the bubble guys from early in the summer when we did the shows, and I put Kakaha firmly on that bubble. Now he's not moves from not being a defensive end to making a team as a linebacker. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Third stringers behind him is Colton Jumper, Nate Stupall, who's mostly going to be a special teams guy, Jerome Elliott, Keyshawn Freeman. Those are the long shots. Some of those guys are long shot guys or practice squad guys. Going to the secondary now. You got Ken Crawley sitting next to Marshawn Lattimore. So we got Ken Crawley before you walk it, sitting next to the young rookie, all pro Marshawn Lattimore, who continues to step it up a bit. And then, of course, you look at the safeties who we had a show asking this question to fans of who going to be the starting safeties. The Saints say, you know what, we're going to just start them all. Look at that. You got Kurt Coleman, Von Bell, and Marcus Williams started in the unofficial depth chart. That says a lot. But Von Bell thrown in the mix. I won't say the Kenny Vaccaro role. I don't want to say that because I think he's going to be better than Kenny Vaccaro was ever at that role, simply because he knows what he's looking at and he can read and react and make plays. So I think Kurt Coleman will be a blessed addition to this team. Remember, he was the first person the Saints picked up when free agency started. The Saints got this guy right before free agency even kicked off. The Panthers released him and the Saints signed him. He's the first one. They said, we want Kurt Coleman, and they went and got him. So Coleman's there with Bell and Williams. Very interesting. Then you go into the second stringers, PJ Williams, who had interception against Drew Brees in camp. We're going to need more of that, PJ. Definitely going to need more of that. This is PJ's last year on the team. Very interesting. PJ has to step up this year and play well. And then the other cornerbacks on the other side is Patrick Robinson, of course, and Natrell Jameson. Of course, Patrick Robinson is going to be the third cornerback in the nickel package. PJ is listed as a fourth, but interesting is Natrell Jameson, the rookie from Nebraska. Very interesting. Very interesting. I remember Natrell can kick return, punt return. He's 6 feet tall, has blazing speed. He's listed in the second stringers. Very interesting. Watch out, PJ. Watch out. watch out. And of course, I know PJ and Natrell are friends because they played high school football together in Florida. But this isn't this watch out. Watch out. Third stringers, of course, for the cornerbacks, Arthur Mulette, who's a fan favorite, Devontae Harris, who's trying to make some plays. J2 Garrett, in my opinion, is a long shot. And of course, you look at Cameron Moore, Justin Harder, who's a special teams guy, and Lyndon Stevenson, one of my favorite undrafted guys looking at it. Now, the safeties, you know, Sherrod Neesman and Chris Banjo, special teams guys there. And of course, like I mentioned, I went over them, but mentioned the rest of those guys backfield, the rest of those DBs. But that's interesting. This is what my take on this depth chart. Very interesting moves, to say the least. Nothing spectacularly different than what I would customarily say about this team. Very interesting, but we'll just have to monitor it going forward and see what's going on. But Manti Te'o at the middle linebacker position, most certainly to me, is a very surprising move by the Saints. Also interesting is Sheldon Rankins and David Onyemata together, the Kurt Coleman, Von Bell, Marcus Williams thing. That's a three safety look that the Saints like to run, but when they go to three linebackers, who sees the field? Who do you think see the field? Well, that's my take on it, man. I think it's very interesting. I'm not mad at any of the moves. What are your thoughts on the unofficial depth chart? Chime in the comment section below. Let me know what you think, what you feel about the Saints' unofficial depth chart as they prepare to get ready for those Jacksonville Jaguars coming up on Thursday. So what's your thoughts on that? Holler at me. Let me know. Thank you for listening to today's Rapid Fire on the PRO Media Network. As always, if you like the shows, please donate to us at the Patreon page or become a patron at www.patreon.com/the PRO Media Network. I'm Big Q. Thank you for listening. Peace.
What's up, sports world? The PRO Media Network is on a mission to reach 10,000 subscribers. So besides our regular programs, like the Sports Coma with Big Q and the guys, the Pelican Post Game Report, Rapid Fire TSC, and others, we will be expanding out and offering other content like movie, anime, and gaming reviews for your entertainment. So if you enjoy our content, please donate at our Patreon page. Also subscribe, comment, and share. And help the PRO Media Network reach 10,000 subs. Peace.